Today is April 29th, 1996. The survivor being interviewed is Roman Kent, born Roman Knieker. The interviewer is Ben Weiner. We're in New York, in the United States of America, and this interview will be conducted in English. Today is April 29th, 1996. This is Roman Kent, born Roman Knieker. My name is Ben Weiner. We're in New York City, New York, in the United States of America, and this interview will be conducted in English. Could you please say your name?
Roman Kent.
What was your name at birth?
At birth, it was Roman Knieker, K-N-I-K-E-R.
Did you have a Hebrew name or any nicknames?
Yes, the Hebrew name was Yerachmiel.
What was your father's name?
Father's name was Emmanuel, and my mother's name was Sonia.
What was your mother's maiden name?
Lifshitz.
Where was your father born?
My father was born in Minsk.
And your mother?
My mother was born in Pinsk.
Where were you born?
I was born in Łódź, and so all of my other siblings, two of my sisters, Dasha and Renia, and my younger brother, Leon.
Who was the oldest sister?
The oldest sister was Dasha.
And when was she born?
She was born, I believe, in 1921.
And when was Renia born?
Renia was born in 1923.
And your younger brother?
My younger brother in 1930, and I'm 29.
When were you born?
In 1929.
What was the exact date?
April 18th.
1929. Was Łódź a big city?
Yes, Łódź was a big city. It was actually the second largest city in Poland, and it had a very peculiar configuration, since it had about 600,000 people before the war, and roughly speaking, there was maybe 200,000 Poles, and about 200,000 Jews, and then a lot of Germans.
What was your father's occupation?
My father was a textile factory owner. He had a fairly large textile factory, and that was his occupation.
When had he come to Łódź, do you know?
This I don't know, but from what I can remember, it was many, many years before we were born. So he was really for a long time in Łódź.
Did he have family living in other parts of Poland?
No, from what I remember about my father's family is only his mother, and this also for very few years, because she died when we were very young. So all I remember is very vaguely an elderly woman that lived in the same building with us. And she was quite old already when I remember her.
Do you remember what her name was?
No, I used to call her not by her name, but just by Babka.
And did your mother have family that lived nearby you?
My mother had family. My mother had two sisters and a brother, which lived in Łódź. Łódź actually is in Poland, not Łódź.
What were their names?
Their names were Ciocia, which means Aunt Clara, and her brother was Isaac, and the other sister, it escapes my memory.
Do you remember what your address was in Łódź?
Yes, this I remember. This was Śródmiejska, which is a hard name in English to pronounce, number 38. And by coincidence, or maybe it was meant to be this way, our father's factory was right across the street. And that was a very good deal for my brother and myself, because it was a very big yard which was in the middle of the factory. The factory was like a square father angle. So that was a beautiful place for my brother and me to play around and do all kind of mischiefs.
What kind of things did you play?
Most of the time as kids, we used to play soccer, which was the most common sport among the young boys in Europe.
Was there a league that you were involved with, or did you just play games?
No, I was playing in our school league, if you can call it a league, and when we played in the factory, it was just with my friends. Most of them were school friends.
What position did you play?
It depends. I used to play on attack, or on the right side, never on the left side. But in addition to soccer, I really participated in a number of sports. I liked sports, and although I was short built, I did play usually in our class on the first team. So whether it was soccer or volleyball or basketball or skating, I always used to like to play, and we played on the first team.
What kind of a house was it that you lived in when you were young?
The house that we lived in, it was actually what you could call here an apartment house. It was a multi-story building, and we occupied there one floor there.
How many rooms did you have?
Oh, I never counted, but there were a number of rooms, so that considering the situation in Poland, I think it was considered a very nice house.
Were you a well-off family from your father's business?
Yes. It's a lot of misleading statement about the rich Jews in Poland, which is very misleading, because by and large there was only a small percentage of Jews that were well off. I would say the majority of Jews in Poland were the middle or low middle or poor class. So even to the school that we went, which was the Jewish gymnasium, the people that were well off, they had to pay for it, which was quite expensive.
What kind of neighborhood did you live in?
I never thought about as far as the neighborhood that I lived in. I think I would say it was a mixed neighborhood, although when I think about it, most of the people in our building, I believe they were Jewish. But around us, there were also Gentiles, so that it was not, at least the district that I lived in, it was not what you could call a ghetto. A ghetto was when we went later on during the war, but this was not a ghetto.
Did you have friends or contact with people that were not Jewish?
Yes, but to a very, very small extent. Basically, my friends were the friends from school, and in as much as I went to a private school, I did not go to a public school, which was mixed, Jews and Gentiles. Our school was the Jewish gymnasium, which was strictly for Jewish people, because we studied there Hebrew and Polish, so that my friends were really the friends from my school, and such, they were Jewish.
Do you know if your father did business with non-Jews?
Oh, yes. My father certainly did business with non-Jews. And as a matter of fact, I remember that almost every year for Christmas, we used to go with our father to one of his people that he did business or whatever it was, and we paid them a visit, and I remember that they had the Christmas tree and different gifts and so on. So I remember that.
How was your mother's time occupied?
My mother, I think you might call in what we would call in the United States, was basically a housewife. She took care on the house. She took care on the children, and more or less, since we were four children, it was still a job to do.
Did you ever travel outside of Łódź?
Yes, I did travel. First of all, every summer we used to go out of town during the school vacations. My father had a very nice villa, maybe 30 miles from Łódź. And we used to go there every year, by and large, the whole family, to spend there the summer. And my father used to come there for the weekend. In addition, I did go, my father took me a few times when he went to Warsaw. He went on business and he took me with him, so I remember that. But again, when we're talking 50, 60 years ago, the traveling in Poland is not what we have traveling today here. Traveling in Poland was completely different in those times, not only in Poland, in many countries in Europe. To go 50, 100, 200 miles, it was already a big trip. Today, we don't think anything to go a few thousand miles. You hop on a plane and you go. It's a revolution in transportation. The same way like it is a revolution in the last 50 years in science, in communication. I mean, what exists today, you could only dream about it 50 years ago, and then you were just a dreamer.
What were the means of transportation between Łódź and Warsaw?
Between Łódź and Warsaw, by and large, it was railroad. Cars were very seldom used, and very few people had cars. So that railroad was the most commonly used between Łódź and Warsaw.
Do you remember what the countryside looked like between Łódź and Warsaw?
The countryside basically looked like the word says, countryside. It was a country. It was a lot of small villages scattered around. You had great fields of which the peasants cultivated, so that you had a lot of corn and wheat and potatoes. This was by and large the countryside. You did not have industrial sections coming from Łódź to Warsaw, like we have here from New York to Washington. It was mostly open fields.
Do you remember any of your impressions of seeing Warsaw?
Of course, when you ask me this question today, and you ask me to look back 60 years, I would have to tell you whether Łódź or Warsaw was for me tremendous cities. Yet, when I went back there, maybe 30 years later after the war, and I went to Łódź and to Warsaw, I thought to myself, is this the big city that I thought it was 50 years ago? It is like a miniature in comparison to the cities that I have seen already. And therefore the memories are going back, the memories are that it was tremendous, but yet it was small. On the other hand, however, we cannot forget that Łódź did have about 600,000 people, so it was a large city.
When did you begin school?
I I began school really at young age. I don't remember exactly, but I think about six, seven years old. And as I mentioned before, I went together with all my siblings to the Jewish gymnasium. The Jewish gymnasium was set up in such a way that there was separate school for boys and separate schools for the girls, so that there was a separation between the sexes. And I started there about 6, 7 years, and it was a really very fine school. The teachers in Poland were by and large scholars, and they really knew the subject and they knew how to teach. And our work, really school work, was divided into two halves, what I can call. About half of the day we studied everything in Polish, whether it was Polish language and geometry, mathematics or history, it was all in Polish. Then we also had an additional load, which did not exist in elementary school, in Polish school or the public school, and that was Hebrew. So we studied Hebrew, which also included the history, Jewish history. It included also study of Torah, etc. In our home, we as children did not speak Jewish. We spoke Polish. And of course, since we studied Hebrew, we understood and we could speak Hebrew, but really we did not speak Hebrew at home. My parents spoke to us in Polish, except when they did not want us to understand something. Then they either spoke to themselves Russian or sometimes Yiddish.
What was the composition of a normal school day?
The composition of, you're asking me questions which I already forgot. Remember, that's not only before the war, that's way, way before the war. The composition of the school really consisted basically, we went to school basically six times a week. And because of our dual teaching program, we went to school, I don't remember, 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock, and we studied till about 3, 4 o'clock. So that in a way it was a full day of schooling, and also we went 6 days a week. Now if I were to compare it, which I did go for 1 year to school in the United States, it was much more difficult and it took much more time and effort to go to school, to study, and of course to be a good teacher, a good student, much more than in the United States.
What were your favorite subjects?
When I went to school, I have no favorite subject. The favorite subject was to have none. The favorite subjects would be to go play soccer, play volleyball, play basketball. This would be my favorite subject. So if I go back and recall what they were, this is what they were. My gymnastic was my favorite subject, I would say. But in spite of that, we were a very good student, so that we did apply ourselves, and it was implied that we should be good students. So we did.
What was your family's religious life like?
We were brought up, which you can call more in the Jewish tradition rather than in the religious life. We did not go by and large to the synagogue Fridays or Saturdays. We did go with our father. And here is also the distinction. The boys went with the father to the synagogue. My mother went sometimes with the girls to another synagogue. But we went to the synagogue with our father, which was a very large, very beautiful, large synagogue. And this we went only during the holidays. Not only the high holidays like Yom Kippur or Rosh Hashanah, but we did go to the minor holidays too, whether it was Passover or Hanukkah and so on. We did have a very traditional Jewish home, because these holidays, and really I remember it the best, like Passover, where we had a whole family around the table. And by whole family, I don't mean only our immediate family, but most of the time we had my mother's brother and his family. They were more, or they were less Orthodox, so they used to come always to us, because maybe my mother wouldn't eat there. And we always had the cider, which was a lot of people, and we had, we were playful as children, of course. And I remember this. This was something that sticks in my mind more than many other things. The same thing was with Hanukkah. We would play, we would light the candles. My father liked and enjoyed very much when we were singing Hebrew song. And this is another difference, which I am sorry we don't have in the United States, that when I went to school, in our school, in addition to studying Hebrew, we have learned different songs that go with the holidays, whether it was for Hanukkah, for Passover, or whatever it is, and also songs, generally Hebrew songs, which I have noticed that children hear when they go to Hebrew school and so on. They don't study it. And yet, in my humble opinion, these are the things that stay with me. I can even remember right now many songs which we studied then. So so this is more or less the religious background. And my mother was more religious than my father.
So was tradition something that you appreciated as a child?
Yes, the tradition, the Jewishness was something that we were brought up with. And going to Jewish school, studying about Eretz Yisrael. We also had what you can call almost in many families in Poland. You had this little, what we call a pushka, which was a little can where you donated money for Keren Kayemet. My father also gave a room to a Jewish organization in our factory. It was called Hanoar Hatzioni, so that we were brought up with the spirit of, call it Jewishness, or etc.
What kind of an organization was Hanoar Hatzioni?
Hanoar Hatzioni was an organization, it was a Zionist organization, in particular for the youth, to bring them up in the Zionist spirit. As a matter of fact, my father was thinking about emigrating to, then it was Palestine, I think, and a long time before the war, he bought a piece of land around Haifa, because he was thinking about moving the factory and establishing a factory, textile factory, in Israel. But as I was told later on, as we grew older, the reason we were not going to Palestine, because my mother was always saying, let the kids grow up, let them finish the elementary school. And then when we finish elementary school, she would say, let them finish the high school and then the lyceum. So we just didn't make it. And the war started before we had a chance to emigrate to Palestine.
Did you attend any of the meetings of Hanoar Hatzioni?
I did not attend at that point too many meetings. I was a little too young, except maybe not in any serious way, particularly that I did get a lot of Jewish education and the spirit of in my school that we had. We spoke about Israel, and so that I didn't have the need so much.
Did your father have any political affiliation that you know of?
I really could not say too much about it, whether he had a political affiliation or not. It is something that at that point in my life, before the war, we really did not discuss so much. My father, I mean, he worked quite hard, I think, and we didn't have maybe so much open lines of communication as you have here right now. It's a big difference. Although when we're talking about my father and my mother, there was a big difference between them. The father would always, and my sister would always complain that he sticks always with the boys because he would allow us or give us a lot of things which the girls would not get. I mean, when we were on in the summer vacation, he would buy for us all sporting equipment. Our villa in was a meeting place in a way for all the kids around the neighborhood, because we had a very big, it was not a yard, it was a big field, so that we had there a place to play soccer, volleyball, basketball, and my father liked to give it to us. And also I remember when he used to come for the weekend, he used to take us, means the boys, horseback riding, rather than having it, what you may have here, together with the girls. And at that time, my mother did not participate in this, in any sport activities or horseback riding, that goes without saying. So there was a much bigger distinction, I'll call it inequality, between the upbringing of the girls and boys.
What was your mother like by comparison? How did she relate to you?
No, my mother related to me in a way like maybe we always talk about our mothers, that they are with us. She was with us all the time. And when we came from school, she was there. When we left to school, she was there. She took care on all our needs. And she was very devoted mother to the children. She also, which was funny when I think about it, that my brother and myself, many times we would do certain things that normally we should not do, like, for example, winter to take a bicycle and drive around the dining room around the with the bicycle. Now, we knew that we shouldn't do it, of course, but when my mother told us many times to stop, we knew what is the limit. So that when she said, I'm going to call you father, and when we still didn't stop, till we knew that she's going to do it, then we would stop, because we realized that she did not want to burden our father with unnecessary problems.
We need to stop and change the tape. This is take number 2 of the interview with Roman Kent, April 29th, 1929. At such a young age, were you aware at all of the kinds of changes that were going on in Europe?
Not too much, really. Politically, as I said, we were maybe still too young to discuss or understand it. Our life before the war, at least in my circle, was in a way a carefree life. When I look back on it, maybe it was the best year of my life, although we did feel a certain anti-Semitism, We were aware of it. We were aware of it very often when we went to our school, to the Jewish gymnasium, and we had to pass by the Polish schools or public schools where the Gentiles boys used to call us names and sometimes throw stones at us. We were aware of it that during many holidays there were problems against Jews. We were aware that there was discrimination in universities. But somehow we took them as effects of life at that point.
So you grew up being aware of prejudice against Jews in society?
Yes, to a point I was aware of the prejudices. And yet the few Gentiles that we did know, that my father did business, they were extremely extremely devoted individual to us. And maybe one of the best examples is that way after the war, when I went back to Poland, some people knew me there. I wanted to find a super from our factory. And I did find him, and he came to meet me. And I think from certain points of view, he knew my father better than I, because he was a grown-up, my father was a grown-up. And he told me this story to me and to my wife, that, and he referred to my father as Mr. Knicker, that was his name, still the respect was there. And he would say he was a very unusual person. He said he was a rich man, I was a poor man. He was a capitalist, I was a socialist. But he talked to me and to my family like a human being. And I would do anything for him. And he did. When the Germans came in, when the war started, he did do a lot of things. But this again is maybe the characteristic of my father, that he was an extremely unusual and good person, so that he or even the Germans that worked in our factory, since they were always good with machinery, there were a lot of Germans working in our factory, would say to my father, "Du bist ein anderer Jude, you are a different Jew," and they would do things for my father that normally they could not do. They were not. They should not have done. Once, when they threw us out from our apartment house, they took everything. I mean, just closed the apartment, and we were out. There was one painting of my mother, which I believe my father made for her for the 10th anniversary, which she loved very much, and all she wanted is to get this painting back. And some of this, two or three of these Germans that worked in my father's factory, and of course they became big shots in Kripo, Gestapo, and so on. When my father talked to them, they said, "We will go to the German who took over the apartment and we will talk to him." And they did go and asked them for the painting. But of course, I remember what the German answered. And he said, "Ich möchte das besser verbrennen wie die Juden zu schenken," which means I will better burn it than to give it to the Jews. So that my relationship, I remember with these people that knew my father, was a little different. He was a very unusual man.
When did you become aware of the Nazis for the first time?
Well, I really didn't became aware of, and I like to correct you here, start at the very beginning, because it is my strong convictions that I do not refer to what happened during the Holocaust to Nazis. Nazis was only a small part German population. But what happened during the Holocaust it's not only due to the Nazis. It was the engineers, the politicians, the business people, the lawyers, the doctors. They all took part in the one great big world Holocaust, annihilation of 6 million Jews. And therefore, I avoid and I don't want to refer to the atrocities which were committed by the Germans as Nazis. I do not say that each and every German was guilty of it, but I do not want to refer to these atrocities as only Nazis, because it's a misleading statement and we are giving a wrong trend for the history. We are distorting the history. So, having said this, I can go back to reply to you that I think it was a gradual experience. I mean, I remember when the war started, we were in our summer villa. And once the war started, my father said, there's no sense you rushing to the city, you might as well stay in the country. The schools are closed, so we did. And for us as the kids, we didn't understand it, what's going on much. It was fun. We could watch the sky, and we have seen some planes, some shooting in the skies. We didn't know yet much. Till one day, one of our neighbors came to us and he said, let's run to the city. The Germans are closing by.
Where was your summer villa located?
The summer villa was located in a little, you can call it in a little resort city. I'm just trying to think of the name. Maybe it will come back to me.
Okay.
I knew it, I remembered, and I somehow slipped my mind. It wasn't far, like I say, and he did come back, and we did gather whatever we had, and we took the last. It was like a streetcar, really, or a little train that we took from the from our villa to the city. And you know, you remember certain things, small things, which were important to us as children when we're talking about it. And when we left this villa, we had a very beautiful dog. To us, it was beautiful, I think. And it was beautiful. When we had to run so fast and there were thousands of people, we said we will leave the dog with the super of the villa. And we went to the railroad station. Train start going, sure enough, who is with us? The dog. So she came with us to the city, and we as kids were happy. We didn't want to leave the dog. So we came to the city, and slowly we started to see the problems which are happening. The Jews have to wear an armband. The Jews have to wear a star. The Jews cannot be on the streets in the evening. Then in our factory, they put what they call a Troy handler. It means my father was no more the owner. It was the German who was put in charge, who controlled the factory. Then a little later on, we come one day, our apartment is closed. We have nothing. We were left with nothing. So that we were lucky enough that we still had the factories in a way, so that we moved across the street and we took an empty room there and we stayed there. So that slowly, gradually, it came. We started to feel the squeeze, and then, of course, towards the end of 39. The order was given that everybody has to go to the ghetto. And that is when we went to the ghetto.
How did you react to the first changes that occurred, to having to wear the star and to all the first policies instituted by the Germans when they came in?
You know, it's a difficult question for me to answer. I of course, we resented it. And we couldn't understand and didn't want to understand why. Because at that point, and it was the beginning of the war, we didn't realize what is awaiting us. And I lived in my family in freedom. Maybe not the same freedom, but to us it was freedom. There are certain places we could not go, like I said, even when we passed Polish schools, we were not welcome, but it was in a way freedom. So we were, it was a slow reaction for us as children. The grown-ups, I think, understood it much better. I mean, I remember vaguely when, even before it started, when Germany threw out a lot of Jews to the Polish border and we had to receive them. We made collection for the people, but it was distance. It was far away still from us, from our own life. So we did not understand it yet so well. And, until we came to ghetto.
Do you think that you were sheltered at all by your parents in the early days?
Yes, I think we were sheltered. I think we were sheltered even before the war, in a way, because we lived in, relatively speaking, a very well-off family, so we were sheltered. Yes, we were. And at the beginning of the war, yes, we were sheltered too, I would say. Even when we went to ghetto at the beginning, we were sheltered because my father took a private tutor so that we should study. He said, you go ahead and continue your study. He did not believe that the war will be so long. And here is another, I come back to what I've told you before, that my father was such an unusual person that some of the Germans that worked in the factory, there were about two or three of them, I remember, used to come to us to ghetto almost every week, which was illegal for them because the ghetto was closed. They were Germans. For them to come to ghetto to a Jew was in a Russian Sunday. It was a disgrace. But they would come to us, and when they came to ghetto, everybody would disappear from the streets because they were the big, what it was, Kripo, Gestapo, or whatever. And they would bring my father to us. They would bring some food. As a matter of fact, I remember one day, and really the proper word is they smuggled my father from ghetto. Not in a car, in a horse and buggy. There were not too many cars then. And they took my father out of the ghetto to a German businessman, I think it was the name Scheibler and Grohmann, and these are the people that my father did business. They used to dye some of the textiles for my father. And I know that my father, at the beginning of the war, sent a lot of materials to him for safekeeping. And since we were there thrown in ghetto, they took him out from the ghetto, brought him to the other friend of our father, so that my father could settle with him some accounts, and I know that he paid him for the materials, so that even in ghetto, replying to your question, we were still relatively sheltered at the beginning because my father had more money, and in ghetto, for money you could buy extra food. So that at the beginning was we were much better off than by and large the population. My father also had a certain conviction that he did not want to take any role in in the ghetto. He did not want to be a resort director or anything like this, because his thinking was, and he said, that if I were to take a leadership position in these times and have much more for myself, I could not look other people straight in the eyes after the war. So he did not take any leadership position. Although I would say that because he knew a lot of people, indirectly, we were able to benefit from his knowledge of people. We were able to get a number of things which normally people did not get in the ghetto.
How far was the ghetto from your house?
I really couldn't answer you exactly, but I know it was quite many kilometers from us. And this, in a way, brings me to a story which, when you ask me how far it was, which my kids, when they were young, they always asked me to tell them so many times. It goes back to the little dog which we had.
What was the dog's name?
The dog's name was Lala. Lala, which means a doll. And she was a doll. At that time she had little puppies, beautiful golden puppies. And since we were thrown out from our apartment, she and the puppies were in the factory. And when we went to ghetto, it was a very bad day. It was sleet, it was rain, it was snow, it was just a miserable day. And we walked there for hours to get to ghetto. And there was, like I say, quite a distance, many, many kilometers. It was in a completely different part of the city. And the for us, the kids, we were four of us, you know, we still didn't understand the implication exactly what it is. I mean, we didn't worry, we had parents, they worried for us. Why should we worry at that point? So we were just worried about what happened to the dog, because the dog was left in the factory with the puppies. So our parents were worried about what to do, how to do. We were lucky we got a room in a kitchen for the six of us, so we were also better off than many others. And so at night we hear a little scratching at the door. And who do you think came in? The dog Lala. And how she found us, God only knows, I don't know. She had her golden hair, they were covered with mud, with sleet, with snow. She was tired, but the moment she seen us, she started licking our hands, our faces, the tail was wiggling, and of course we were happy. And a very unusual thing happened for the next few weeks. In the morning, she left us. She went back to the puppies. At night, she came back. So this was her routine for the next few weeks. She would go to the puppies in the morning, stay calm at night, and so on. And in a way, this is a story which my kids wanted me to repeat to them many, many times. But there is also a moral in the story that taught me something too. That love is stronger than hate. No barbed wire, no guns stopped this little dog from loving us, coming to us, and then going back to the children. So it is still a very... I wish people sometimes be like what we call animals.
How did you adapt to living in the ghetto? What were the changes?
With difficulty. This was a problem. First of all, we were not used to be confined in the one room in the kitchen. Number two, even with the extra food which we had, that my father was able to buy for the money he had, it was still tough with the food. We did, however, at the beginning of the ghetto, go to school, which was created or ordered by the leader of the Jews, which we call their Älteste, the Juden Rumkowski. He was really a very caring person before the war, and he cared for children. He volunteered to work. He worked in orphanage, and therefore in ghetto when we came, one of his first thing was to see what to do with and for the children, and he made for us the children a school, and it was pretty far from where we lived, but at the beginning we used to go to the school, which was on Marishin, which was a different part of the ghetto. But like everything else, it got worse and worse, and the school was closed. And that's when our father started to take a private tutor to teach so that we wouldn't lose the time. But even that had to stop after a while. And slowly, what you can call the screw tightened, and we could see that it gets from bad to worse. People were getting very small ration of food. Everybody had to work, so that they used to make what they call resorts, that people had to work there for the Germans. The people that did not work did not get any ration. And you could see really from day to day the starvation which take place in ghetto.
What part of Łódź was the ghetto located in?
In a very poor section of Łódź. Before the war, I never went there to this section, so it's not, I didn't know much about it. But it was in the poor section of Łódź, and like I say, the situation was very bad. The starvation was pronounced from day to day. You could see sick people on the streets, dying people on the streets. There was not enough people to bury the dead people, so you could see them with a horse and buggy being sent out from ghetto for burial. And you know, it's still an amazing thing that in spite of all of this, at least my experience where I went, when I worked in the ghetto, which was called the Leather and Sattler Resort, which means, how to translate it, where we were sewing some leather knapsacks for the soldiers. It was mostly, this particular resort was mostly for young people. Somehow, coincidence, we were a lot of young people working in this resort. And we have understood that if we're going to work so hard, like in many other resorts, just to get another piece of bread, we're going to use too much energy. And therefore, and this is really, in ghetto, there was a creation of a certain, call it a communist movement. And some of the leaders in the communist movement, some of them were very good friends of mine that went to school together. They organized, and particularly our resort was excellent to it, that we did what we would call here in the United States like slow down strikes. When the management wanted us to do 10 pieces a day, we would do only two. And we realized that the management would be afraid to do anything to us, because if they openly would say that, hey, you've got a slowdown strike, they would be punished by the Germans. So in a way, we were playing them against the Germans, and we are saving our lives by very low production. So I say this because in many instances, I heard so many times being said that the Jews didn't do anything. They went like a sheep to the ovens. But it's not true, because this was also a resistance. Resistance does not have to be with a gun and a bullet. As a matter of fact, sometimes the easiest resistance is with a gun and a bullet. But many times the consequences of taking a gun and shooting a German would be that they would take 100 other people and kill them. So that would not accomplish much. But a resistance like this is a resistance. A resistance when a mother gave a piece of bread to the child so that he could survive, it is a resistance. A resistance was in the Łódź ghetto that we had symphony orchestra. And this orchestra played, and it was cold. But by playing in ghetto, they gave the people the will to live another day and another day and another day. Yes, it was maybe not legal, but it was a resistance. A teacher that was teaching the children in ghetto, it was resistance, it was illegal. So that there are many other forms of resistance, which is spiritual and moral and so on. And this was one part. We were singing songs about the slowdown strikes, satirical songs.
Do you remember how any of them went?
I remember, but I am afraid that if I will start singing, you will have to finish the interview because my voice is so good. But some of the lines were something that that the workers here are heroes in a way, and that we are not afraid so much of what they will do to us, because we know that the director will give us a ball to play and so on. After all, he's our friend, which of course was satirical, you know. So there were this kind of satirical songs.
Do you remember where the tunes came from?
From the tunes? No, I don't remember what it came from. I mean, I know, but like I say, if I would start singing, you would finish it right now. But it goes something like Bohatersko się spisało rymarska prać, gdy kierownik o redukcji ceny dał znać. Znać się wszyscy zbuntowali i nie chcieli szyć już dalej. Pan kierownik ojcem nam jest tak, ach tak, and so on and so on. So it was, but this you could do only with young people. The older generation did not understand it. They wanted to get another piece of bread, but they would be dropping at the machines like flies.
We're going to stop now, James.
Yes, I've seen it.
This is tape number 3 of the interview with Roman Kent, April 29th, 1996. Can you tell me a little bit about how the ghetto was organized administratively?
I could give you, and I am projecting myself right now, what I knew when I was living there, because today what you know is completely different what the perception was when we were in ghetto. So I have to go back and tell you what we thought and what I thought then. The perception was that at the beginning, Rumkowski thought that by keeping the ghetto together and keeping the Jews confined there and working for the Germans, the thought was that maybe he will be able to save the Jewish people. And this is one of the reasons why at the very beginning he took the children to school. He wanted them to study. As, however, the condition changed, the perception changed too. The situation in ghetto became such that there was a great disparity between the so-called, what you asked, the administration and the common man. The Judenrat, and they called it the Beirat, which was the leadership there, were getting a lot of food, a lot of privileges, while the common man had very little to eat and they were starving. So that the antagonism between the administration, and there were maybe few types of administrations, because there was the administration as such, then there was a police, which was a different part of the organization or administration. The resentments against the Beirut, the leadership, the resentments against the police, which was completely independent, really. It was a Jewish police, not accompanied by the Germans, became more and more. And as the time progressed, the problem started that you had Aussiedlungs, you had people that were being sent out from ghetto. You had old people, young people. I mean, one of the worst things was when he said all children have to be sent out from ghetto. Old people had to be sent out from ghetto. Sick people had to be sent out from ghetto. The people that work for the Forum Koski, whether that was in the administration or in the police department or anything else, they were in a way exempt from the Aussiedlung, from being moved out from ghetto. So there became more and more friction between the population and the administration of ghetto. It reached a point where the starvation was such that it was a complete distrust to the leadership, and in a way, we also started to think that Rumkowski, as the head of it, became so powerful that he became like the king of the Jews. And this also created a tremendous resentment. He would drive in the horse and buggy, beautiful horse and buggy, with some of his people surrounding him, and well-fed, looking beautifully. This by itself, when you are hungry, and you're starving, and your family starving, and you look at people so well-fed, yet supposedly that should be in the same condition, it creates much more problems than normally you can foresee. And this is what was happening in the ghetto. There was the so-called privileged class and the underprivileged class. And in a way, we were a little privileged too, because we were able to get what we call jauki, which means a piece of land. And a piece of land which basically my brother and myself, we became farmers. We have learned how to cultivate the land. We have learned that within a short period of time that, for example, we can plant potatoes, but between the time that the potatoes will grow, we can have some lettuce. So we would take the lettuce in within a few weeks and then the potatoes. So we had, by and large, more food, because this chowki is this little piece of land which was very difficult to get, and yet we got it. Saved us both during the summer and gave us some food for the winter. Now, we did work very hard for it, because you didn't have an irrigation. I know my brother and myself, we had to bring water in buckets and water these plants, particularly when they were young. Then when they were growing, we had to bunch ourselves, the people that had these jaukis, these pieces of land, and we had to watch it day and night, because the moment they started to grow, if we would not watch it day and night, starving people would just overrun it. So even the resentment grew, that the people that had more, there was a building up of resentments against the one that had nothing.
What was the German presence in the camp through all this, or in the ghetto through all this?
The German presence in the ghetto, as I have seen it, was very limited, really. And by and large, we did not have a direct contact with the Germans, by and large. Every now and then they would come to the ghetto, and if they came, the streets would be empty from us. So that was not so visible in the ghetto, at least at the beginning. Later on, when they started the Auschwitz, then of course they came in too. But even that was done mostly by the Jewish police. So that every now and then we would have some big shot Germans coming to our resort and inspecting the merchandise, inspecting what we are doing. But we did not have such a direct contact. Yes, they would go sometimes, if they are going and somebody was in their way, they would beat them up or do things like this. But by and large, it was minimal. Sure, if you had people that were smuggling food or other things from ghetto or to ghetto, if they were caught, then they had problem with the Germans. But this again was incidents. It was not a widespread situation.
You mentioned a symphony that played. What kind of events like that were there in the ghetto?
It's an amazing thing that even under the most trying circumstances, I would say the spirit, call it the Jewish spirit or the spirit of man, somehow could still flourish. And you had people like Beigelmann, who was directing the symphony concert in Łódź. He was not only conducting the orchestra, but he was also composing music. So that this played an important part in giving us the will to live. That even under the most trying circumstances, you could have the intellectual life that existed before the war, and you could have it still in the ghetto.
Under what conditions was the music performed? Where and how?
The music were really particular. Later on, performed in big rooms and halls. And it was not heated, there was later on no heat, so that it was performed really under most trying circumstances. And people really, when they had to play with their fingers, the instrument, it really was very, very difficult. And I don't think one has a concept sitting here what it means to play under such circumstances.
Do you remember what kind of music they would play?
All kinds of music, but mostly classical music.
And how long did you work for in the ghetto? Did you always have the same place of work, or did it change?
I worked mostly in the same place of work. Again, it was maybe a coincidence, but where I worked in the leather and zapter resort, the director of the resort was somebody that I knew from before the war, because his son and I went to the same school, to the Jewish gymnasium, so that I knew his father. And as a matter of fact, once during such a slow down strike, he would call me in and he say, "Roman, what are you trying to do to us? We will all get killed. You shouldn't be doing a thing like this here. You should be having more production and sewing. Why do you do a thing like this?" And I was in a predicament, because he knew me, I knew him, and I was telling him simply that we cannot sew anymore. And his son was also involved in this, call it revolt. And so this was the our position then.
What was happening to the rest of your family?
And one more thing, which I had the privilege while I worked there, that my brother and myself, we could finish the production really very fast. And then, because of the circumstances that we knew the people, the supervisor and the director, we were able somehow illegally to sneak out from the resort, go to the field and cultivate the vegetables in the garden and so on. That gave us also a great benefit.
My question was, what was happening with the rest of your family, with your parents and your sisters?
My brother worked part of the time with me, and my sister also worked, sometimes in different places.
Your older sister?
My older sister worked, and the youngest, they were both older than me, but the older sister worked also in the resort places. My youngest sister, they both were part of the time, they had better job, because part of the time they worked in a bakery, where they made bread. That was a very good position, because at least you could get some extra food while you were at work. You were not supposed to smuggle out anything. But while they worked, they were able to get more bread. So that helped quite a bit, because then they didn't have to eat so much at home. And my mother worked also. Everybody had to work. And my mother worked also in a resort, in a sewing resort. And my father worked there too. As I said, he didn't want to take a leadership role. And he died in ghetto, really. Of course, he died really, you can call it, from malnutrition and so on, because he had some ulcers, and with the improper diet which he had in ghetto, it just flared up a few times. And the last time it flared out to such an extent that he lost too much blood. There were not enough medical treatments to do it, so that he died in ghetto.
When did he die?
He died in, I think, 43.
How did your family react after that?
We reacted, very difficult question, like everything else when you lose your father, even under the worst of the circumstances, you react the way that you lost your father. It was just a tragedy for us. And I know that shortly thereafter we also had another bad tragedy in ghetto, that my mother was called to the cripo, and they normally the people go there, they don't return. And she came back maybe about 5-6 days later. We would go there every day and stand there by the cripo. And I think for about a week, or maybe longer, she just didn't even want to undress. She was just completely out of her mind, because what they wanted from her is to find out from her where did we hide the jewelry and money. And by then we didn't have any more, so there's nothing she could give them. So they used to beat her up, and so, and some of the people in Kripo, Germans, they spoke Jewish very well, so they would ask her question in Jewish, and so, and that was a very terrible thing for us to see our mother completely bewildered.
Where was it that she had been called to?
It is called Kripo. It's like a criminal polizei. It was a part of the German, whatever it was, I don't know. And they wanted to get the jewelry and money from the Jews.
And this happened
in the ghetto.
Right after your father's death?
Yeah, it was after my father died. That's why they didn't take my father. He was not alive, so they took my mother. And,
were you able to give your father a burial in the ghetto?
Yes, in a way. There was a cemetery which was maybe outside of the ghetto, but part of the ghetto, so that he was able to be buried there. So that after the war, we were able to locate, because the cemetery, I don't know exactly how it worked, but I think the Polish man who took care on the cemetery before the war, he was there still during the war, and he was the caretaker, so that he had the records where who was buried in which lot, so that after the war we were able to locate it and put a stone on my father's grave. So,
do you have a sense of how or if Jewish rituals were carried out in the ghetto?
When you say Jewish rituals, what do you mean?
I mean observance of holidays or...
To a point, yes. If you had religious Jews who were religious before the war, many of them observed the rituals, although they could not do many things. So, you know, it's misleading that they could observe all the rituals, because you didn't have many things that you could observe. You did not have meat which was kosher. You did not have a lot of things which were kosher. So that from this point of view, you could not observe it. But again, I believe the rabbis said that it's okay to do what you have to do to save yourself. So that, yes, they were observed to a certain point. The religious Jews would pray, would observe the holidays.
Did you ever see, or were you ever involved in the celebration of a holiday in the ghetto?
In the ghetto? At the beginning we had the celebration of the holiday, but later on our family, it was just too tough. We did not, and we were not religious to such an extent that was to us the primary importance, I would say, from that point of view.
How long were you in the Łódź ghetto?
I was really in the Łódź ghetto. Our family, we were from the beginning till the liquidation of the Łódź ghetto. We were in the Łódź ghetto till the fall of 1944, when they liquidated the Łódź ghetto completely.
And at that point, you were still together with your sisters and your brother and
yes.
your mother?
Yeah. This in a way makes a tremendous distinction between a concentration camp and a ghetto, because in the ghetto we were with the family. How bad, how miserable the conditions were in the ghetto, you came home to your family, which you did not have in the concentration camps. The second thing, at least in the ghetto where I was, that we did not participate and we were not part of the daily brutality which existed in concentration camp. So I would say, if I look backwards, these were the two main distinctions between the Łódź ghetto for our family and the concentration camps. Because you have to realize that many families in Łódź ghetto were sent out on the Auschwitz and so on, then their experiences would be different than ours.
How often were Jews sent from the Łódź ghetto to concentration camps? How often were the transportations from the ghetto to camps while the ghetto was in existence?
There were all the time some kind of Aussiedlungs that we as such living there in ghetto did not know all the time, but we knew that they are in existence all the time, because they would ask different people to appear in certain places that did not walk all to say and so on, so they were appeared all the time.
Did you know about concentration camps when you were in the ghetto?
I mean, personally, I did not know. Looking back, I know from history there may have been some people that had clandestine radios and so on, but we, our family, we did not know about it. It was a well-hidden secret.
Did you ever think about the future when you were in the ghetto?
We didn't think about future in the ghetto, maybe at the very beginning. You don't think about the future, and even less so later on in concentration camps. You think from day to day, from hour to hour, from minute to minute.
Did you think about the past?
You know, sometimes at the beginning, yes, but later on, it is the same thing what I said a moment ago. You think about the next minute, about the next hour.
What do you remember about the liquidation of the ghetto?
There is certain thing which I vividly remember, and it may be a paradox that certain things I don't remember at all. The incident which I remember distinctly about the liquidation was that I was with my brother on the field where we were watching the crops, and in another few weeks maybe we would take the potatoes and other things for the winter, and as we're watching God, and everybody was there because we have seen that there is some kind of problems arising in ghetto. There is what we call hafkir. It means everybody does what they want. There is somehow we're losing the structure of organizational structure. So we were watching the fields, and then suddenly thousands of people just came in from all the sides and overran us, all of us that were guarding the fields. And I remember here is my brother and myself worked the whole summer for it to have the food for the winter. You see, we did not yet think about that we are going to be sent out from the ghetto. We were only thinking that this is our food for the winter, which we have prepared, and it's all gone. Within 1 hour, the whole field was overrun. Whatever it was there was pulled out, and we were left crying and saying, what is going to happen? But then, of course, what was been happening, like I say, it was a disorder in the whole ghetto. Everybody would try to steal whatever they could, bakery, food, all the places. And here is what I don't remember. How did we get out from ghetto? This particular part is completely what I believe they call tabula rasa. My mind is blank. To such an extent that later on my sister told me the last day in ghetto, which I still could not visualize. And she said when all this outsiddling were taking place, this from ghetto, we hid ourselves in like a double wall. It was a shifter or something like this. And the Germans came in, and somehow they found us, and they chased us out to the trucks. And from there, we went to Bawutski Rynek or so, and we went to the freight cars. This is how we entered the ghetto. And if she would not tell me, I would not know, and there's no reason that she would tell me anything wrong, but this part of the Auschwitz is completely blank in my mind.
Do you wonder why you don't remember?
I imagine it is because of what happened on the fields where we lost everything. This was number one. And then number two, when we were found, this is what she tells me, when we found by the Germans there, that was also had an impact on my mind or whatever it is, that they just blanked out. I don't remember anything.
We're going to change the tape now.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I can start this really.
This is tape number 4 of the interview with Roman Kent. April 29th, 1996.
You know, it's just like certain parts which happened in ghetto, how we were caught and sent out, I could not remember. The other parts which yet they stay vividly in my mind. For example, if when I've told you that we went to school at the beginning of the ghetto in Marishin, and maybe it's a coincidence, but later on in the ghetto, being there and going to school helped us to survive the winter in the ghetto. And the reason was that most of the homes in the Marishin were wooden homes. So what my brother and I used to do, we used to go there to this Marishin and take the wood, put apart the homes and take the wood and smuggle it into ghetto. And this way we had some, call it coal, wood, to have some heat in our room. This got more difficult and more difficult, and then we came into an ingenious way of smuggling the wood by building from this wood a very heavy, we wanted as heavy as possible because we were interested in the wood. We were building such, I don't even know how you call it in English, such a thing where you can, like a frame, where you can put old cans of paint and other things, and you hold it on both sides, and the painters use it to transport some of the cans of paint, and we would build a thing like this, which was very heavy, and we would put few cans of paint, and we would go straight to the through the guard with this lumber in our hands. And this is how we would go it every week, once or twice, and we had wood for the winter. So you had to use sometimes luck or ingenuity to do things. You took chances.
What do you think would have happened to you if you were caught?
That would be the end of us. That's it. If they would know what we do. Because if we were caught and they would just think that we are carrying the paint, that's one thing. But if they knew that we were breaking into the house, putting them apart and constructing this contraption to smuggle the wood to our home, that would be the end.
Are there any other strong memories you have of the ghetto?
Oh, I mean, it's just the daily life, the visual tragedies which we've been witnessing day in and day out, looking at the people, at the dead people being carrying on the, not horse and buggies later on, because there were no horses anymore, but it was drawn down by people. You had also the secretments from the houses were put in barrels, and they were drawn by people, not by horses. So that the misery which prevailed daily, which is a constant reminder as to what was happening in the ghetto.
How old were you when the ghetto was liquidated?
No, I was then about 16, 17, 44.
And what was the progression of events following the liquidation?
The next thing, what I remember, is that we were in the cattle car. The cattle car, we were so tight next to each other that really there was basically room for standing. You could not lay down. And what I remember being in the cattle cars for maybe 3 or 4 days. No food, no water. And people were dying in the cattle car. How many people died, we don't know. I don't know. We were together, the five of us, my two sisters, my mother, my brother, and myself, and we were like together in one place. And the next thing, after the few days traveling, and we did not know exactly how long, where we go, all we knew is that the train is going. We knew the train is stopping. We could feel the train goes back. We felt the train is being connected somewhere else. We see the movements, we hear the movements. Where we go, we don't know. And then the next thing I remember is suddenly the cattle car doors opened with a force. And we hear tremendous noise. It's really wrong to say noise. It's a combination of sounds of crying women, crying children, yelling, giving orders, dog barkings, and the light which struck us when they opened the door. because in a way after a few days we were, call it, accustomed to the darkness, so that the opening of the doors created like a lightning to us. We could hardly see, so the noise is the first thing that we could hear. And we slowly started to distinguish the noise, and the commands all arouse everybody to get out. And as we were walking out, the thing which struck me, as the noise multiplied, the barkings of the dogs became louder, the crying of the women and the children penetrated the air, and we started to see, not only to hear, but to see what's going on, the masses of people being pushed, being beaten by people standing, by Germans sitting on horses, beating them and yelling, "Forwards, go, go, alles raus." I also have seen, and this was maybe the first time when I really encountered the actual brutality. I've seen, like, from the cattle cars, not only from ours, but there was a whole train of the cattle cars, everybody going out from the cattle cars. And I have seen some in the cattle cars, you had a policeman who was a policeman in ghetto. And these were the people that I think were killed almost immediately by the people. I have seen, like, they would throw the policeman on the ground, beat him, stay on him, on his throat with their boots, till you could see the blood all over. And this was the first picture of this killing of these policemen coming out. And then really this is one of the times, maybe the only time, that I really lost completely control of my movements, of my ability to think. But this is maybe the time where I became like a sheep in the flock, going with the crowd without knowing what I am doing, or unconsciously knowing what we're doing. And this is a time when they separated us, that means my brother and myself, from my sisters and my mother. And this is really the last time that we have seen them, till after the war, where we met my two sisters. So that is a sight you cannot forget. I don't think if Shakespeare were alive, he would be able to describe a day in Auschwitz like this. You know, a lot is being said about historians studying the Holocaust, studying what was going on. But I don't think that anyone, regardless how many degrees he will have, how many books he will study, can ever comprehend or understand 1 hour in Auschwitz. There's no way. There's no way to describe it. There's no way to tell anyone. There's no way to convey for the future the pain, the agony, the tragedy which was happening there. So we we went, my brother and I, in this long line, and wherever they told us, we went. We just lost our sense of freedoms, of anything. We just went. And eventually, we went to the bathhouse with a shower. They gave us some clothes, which of course did not fit, and straw. And we were sent, when I say Auschwitz, it is really incorrect, because we really went to Birkenau, likely, which was the large camp for all the Jews. Auschwitz itself was a small camp, but where only a small part of the people were sent to. 90-95% of us went to Birkenau, which was a camp next to Auschwitz, a few miles away. And we have found ourselves in a camp in this Auschwitz-Birkenau, which somehow was called the Zigeunerlager, the Gypsy Camp. And this was a camp that, contrary to many other small parts in Auschwitz or in Birkenau, where the people were sent basically for annihilation, not for work, not for anything. And they call it the Gypsy Camp, I found out later, because in this particular camp, some time ago, they sent all the gypsies and they killed them, and the name became the Gypsy Camp, the Zigeuner Camp. So that's where I spent, and I was sent with my brother there, to this Gypsy Camp in Auschwitz, Birkenau. What can you say about this Birkenau? If you go there today, you can see, as far as your eye can see, chimneys. Every few meters you see a chimney. But during the time I was there, each chimney represented maybe 1,500 to 2,000 people in a barrack, wooden barrack. There was not much place to sleep. There were some bunk beds, but there were four, five, six people laying together in one space. And the 1,500, 2,000 people in the barrack were just subjected to inhuman conditions, which means very little food, constant beating, constant staying on an uphill, winter, cold, snow, you're staying without any clothes. And every day you could see a whole mountain in one corner of the barracks of dead people that did not survive the day. it was just sheer slaughter. You could be killed for nothing just because you were standing somewhere and the capo or the German just beat you to death for anything you did, you didn't stay properly in a row, they would give you 50 lashes, and after 30, you were dead, it didn't matter. So it was a very, very dreadful conditions and situation which existed in this camp. coming from Łódź ghetto and being thrown immediately in such a condition without a graduating some kind of a transition period, it was even more pronounced on me than somebody who graduated went into such a bad condition. I know that how long I was there, I don't know. And if anybody asks a question and wants to know, all I can say, he does not understand the condition. He cannot visualize the condition for anyone to think that he could think properly to know how many days or how many weeks he was there. Days didn't count. I know only that after a while, having been forced there and having no food, I know that one day I maybe was crazy, but I did a desperate thing where I stole a bread, which, by the way, we did not call stealing. We called it organizing, because stealing is something against our ethics. So when somebody, put it in quotation marks, stole something like bread, that was, we organized it. And I organized such a bread from a bakery when they were carrying a lot of breads. This was really something that I did out of desperation, because had I been caught, then I would immediately be killed or tortured. That's it. So somehow, but we were so hungry after, I don't know, a few days or a week, that you just took measures that you normally shouldn't take. And when I look back on it, and the unusual thing would happen, that I did take the bread, and the Germans did not see it. But I had few thousand eyes that have seen it, and these were also the inmates of this camp. And the moment I took the bread and pulled out from the eyes of the Germans, the few thousand inmates of Auschwitz jumped on me, and we had a pile of people consisting of a few hundred people on top of me. And I am holding the bread, being on the bottom of the pile, so that when finally the Germans have seen what is going on, a pile of people on top of another, and they started to beat them so that everybody dispersed, I was on the bottom of the pile, and all I had is maybe 2 crumbs of bread in my fist. That's what it was left. So it's difficult for somebody who wasn't then to understand it. Therefore, in a way, my brother and myself, after a while, decided that we better see what we can do to get out from the camp. And every now and then we noticed that they have asked who is a tailor, who is a shoemaker, who is a other professions, and we have seen some people came out and say, we are these. And we found out that some of them are really not what they asked for. But we found out that this is one way of getting out from the camp. So we have decided that next time they're going to ask for somebody, we will volunteer, we are them. And in this way, we felt that we will get out from this camp where every couple, every Stubenältester, everyone with power could just kill you for anything. for no reason at all. And so, so it happened that we put our plan into action, and the next time they asked for some people that are experts in certain fields, we raised our hands, we got out from the row, and this is how we left the Birkenau, the Zigeunerlager.
When was it that you left?
Oh, again, exactly when it was, I don't know. How long exactly I was in the gypsy camp, I don't know. But I know it must have been in the beginning of winter, because it was extremely cold with snow.
It was 1944.
That was the winter of 1944.
How were you taken out of the camp?
We were taken out of the camp on a train, a cattle car, and we again spent some time traveling. And from what I understand, we were sent to some other camps, which were in the section of Gross Rosen. They had a number of concentration camps in Gross Rosen section.
This was in Germany itself?
That was in Germany. That's Gross Rosen. That was in Bavaria, in the section of Bavaria. And there in the camps, they the condition, if you compare this to Auschwitz, you might say were relatively better. And they send us to work. Most of the work was either what they call Steinbruch, which means breaking of stones, or in the forests in Bavaria, then, in the mountains. And of course, it was very cold. The work was very difficult. They would wake you up at sunrise or before sunrise. You had to stay for an hour or two sometimes on the Appellplatz, where they were counting you if everybody's there. And they would send you on the guards to the Steinbruch or the forest, chop woods or to break the stones. That was mostly the work that we had to do there. And this is how we worked there. I, in a way, was a little lucky that every now and then I was able to stay in the camp instead of going out to work and do some work in the camp, because they always needed few people in the camp to take care on the, to clean up the barracks. They needed some people to work in the kitchen, so that I was able somehow to maneuver quite often to stay in the camp. And this was a big thing for both of us, for me and for my brother, because when I stayed in the camp, then I was able to organize, which means to steal some food, so or some extra piece of cloth, so that when my brother came from work, he was able to get a little more food from me. So he had more than just the regular amount that they gave him, and he had extra piece of cloth or so. So that was a good way of surviving from day to day. Not that it was not dangerous to steal something, because if they caught you, they would kill you, shoot you or so. And I know that whenever I worked in the kitchen, I would I would tie my longhorns, and then whenever I could, I would put that under my pants, a few potatoes or carrots, whatever it was done. And of course, we had to go through the Germans at the guardhouse, so if they have seen something, they would shoot you. And I remember one incident when another person worked with me, and I've seen that what he did was he took so much that his pants were bulging. And I knew that when his pants are bulging like this, he's got to go through the guardhouse. They're going to find him unless he's going to be lucky enough that they will not look. And I've told him, look, it's you're taking too much. You will have problem getting through the guardhouse. And he told me, look, you do what you want and I'll do what I want. And I know that this day I did not take anything. I wanted to be completely clean because I was afraid that if he is caught, I'll be caught too, whether I have something or not. So at least if I don't have anything, whatever punishment they will give me, it wouldn't be bad, but he might be killed. And sure enough, we went through, he got caught, he got killed, and that's the way it was. So you had to take chances.
We're going to pause the tape now. This is tape number 5 of the interview with Roman Kent, April 29th, 1996.
There is no question when people ask, how do you survive? It's no question that luck was maybe the most important part as to how you survive. I would say, however, that in addition to the luck, it did help sometimes to have some ingenuity. It helped. But this by itself would not suffice. One of the incidents, maybe I could say, was that when we were in these camps in the Gross-Rosen section, they had a number of concentration camps. And with the winter, which is there in Bavaria, very hard winter, cold. The Germans came with a gimmick and they said, of course we didn't know it was a gimmick, but they said that we would like to take all the children to one camp and we will send them to factory to work so that they will be warm. It was quite a plausible explanation, so that I would say most, if not all, the young people, children from all these camps in Gross-Rosen volunteered. And they put us to one camp. We were about 805 children in this camp. We came there. And I don't know how or what, but the grapevine started to circulate that we're not going to go to the factory to work, but we are going to go to Auschwitz, to crematoria. We stayed there for a few days doing nothing, and then they send us to work. It's a funny thing that going to work in the cold winter, suddenly everybody was happy because we have noticed that if we go to work, we're not going to go back to Auschwitz. So we were happy. And we worked like this for a few days till one day after we went to work, they called everybody back and they collected us on the Appellplatz and they started counting. The Germans are there, the Lager commander, and so on. And as it happened, I needed to go to the toilet. You couldn't just go and leave. You had to ask permission. So I was standing close by the Germans. And I noticed there is a lot of commotion. They are angry and so on. And we're standing there for maybe an hour, 2 hours, freezing cold. And suddenly they are bringing up two young boys. And since I wanted to go to the toilet, I was just standing there, and I heard when the Lager commander, the German in charge of the camp, said to his associate and to the Jewish Lager commander, he said, "Wenn die haben so viel Blatt sich verhalten, da bleiben sie hier." Which means, if they had so much guts to hide themselves, let them stay here. Now, I don't know what made me do what I did. But when I heard this, I jumped out from my row, and for this alone you could be shot. And I went to this commander, who was like God, and I said to him, "Herr Kommandant, I am here with my brother. We are both young. We would like to stay here and work." He looked at me and says, "Where is your brother?" So I told him, "Here." So I said, "Come here." So he called my brother there too. And then the Jewish leader of the camp said that I have here a family member, can he stay there too? So the German said yes. And so there were five boys left out of the 805 of boys that were brought in from all the camps together. The rest, what happened? The reason they called us back to the Appellplatz, because it came a transport from Auschwitz of grown-ups. So they took the grown-ups, which came from Auschwitz to work, and they sent all the children back to Auschwitz, to crematorium. Now, why did they leave the five people? According to the Germans, everything has to be in order. What happened? They have sent 800 grown-ups, and therefore they had to send back 800 children. So everything would be in order. This is how five of the children were left while all the 800 went to Auschwitz to die.
How much more time after this do you think you spent in Grossrosen?
Again, exactly, I don't know, but we spent a few months. And in a way, for us, for the five boys, we had a little better time in this camp because we were then sent as Stubendienst, so we were sent mostly to stay in the barracks, to clean the barracks, to work around the barracks. So that was a great privilege, because all the rest of them were grown-ups and we were the only youngsters. From there, we were sent to what I would say our last camp, which was Flossenbürg.
Where is that located?
Flossenbürg is also in the Bavaria in Germany. And this was a camp which was really, in a way, a working camp. At least part of the camps was working camp, except for few of the few barracks which were not for work. And we were sent to the bed barracks where it was not for work, just for beating and so on. And this is the last camp where I was. And
do you know what time of year it was when you came there?
When I came to Flossenbürg, it was the beginning of 45. We were in Flossenbürg really till April of 45. And again in Flossenbürg, like the other camps, at least the few barracks that we were barracks which were not working barracks. It was basically for annihilation. So that you had a similar situation like in Auschwitz, that you could die for nothing because the couples in each individual blacks, in addition to the Germans that controlled it, each couple, each black Ältester, the leader of the black, could kill you for nothing. They control you life and death, so that they had every night they would play, they would have dances, they would sing, and when they got drunk, they would throw the dishes right on the prisoners. And who got killed, they didn't care. They would just beat us up at night. You have no night, you have no days. And we were like this till about April. I believe in the middle of April, an unusual thing happened that we have seen suddenly that the German left. And they left behind them just few guards guarding the camp. And basically they left. So we didn't know exactly what to make out of it, but we were happy to see them gone. However, our happiness didn't last long. A few days later, they came back. And what they did, they evacuated the camp. We found out that the camp is being evacuated to Dachau. What they did is, this camp consisted also, the big camp consisted of both Jews and Gentiles. And what they did, they asked all the Jews to go separately, and they took the Jews, and they were the first one to get out from the camp. At that point, my brother and myself decided we were going to hide among the Gentiles. So we did. We hid ourselves among the Gentiles, and shortly thereafter, they took the... and I noticed a lot of Jewish people hid themselves among the Gentiles because it was already disorganized at that point. They didn't know exactly what happened. We were able to wrap all the means of wherever there was some food, the kitchen, the warehouses, everything, each one of us, whatever could take some food, took with us. And then they divided the balance of the people in the camp into groups of about 4,000, and they started to marching us. Basically, we were walking at night, and during the day they would surround us most of the time in a little hillside in the forest, and they surrounded the Germans surrounded us, and we stayed there during the day. It was raining, pouring, and we were tired walking all night, but we fell down wherever we could and we slept, whatever it was, in the mud. We had, You know, all the time that I was in the camp, my brother and myself, we were always together. We never separated. There were times where they wanted to separate us, but somehow we were able to change the names or the numbers with some other friends who also were supposed to be separated, so that we went together and the other brothers, or father and son, went together. So when we were on this march here at night, being on this hillside, and we had a little food which we got from the camp before we departed, my brother would tie me into a tree and the food so that I wouldn't roll down, and he would sleep next to me so nobody would steal the food. And it worked okay for a few nights. But I think the third night, somebody somehow, and we were that tired, you have to realize, somebody cut the rope, and I ended somewhere completely different with no food. So we were talking to ourselves, now it's bad, because we already out of food. You have to realize that the march was not an easy march. And what was happening to the people that could not march, they fell down on the roadside and the Germans shot them. So that throughout the night, all we could hear, tra-ta-ta, tra-ta-ta, because whoever dropped was shot. And thousands of people were shot every night. So what happened the fourth day as we marched, as we stayed surrounded in the forest, they suddenly called us in and they say, "Alle raus," and we started to march. At that point, as I say, we didn't have any food, and we felt already lousy after all this walking, and we felt we cannot march much longer. And we were falling slowly, slowly towards the end of the columns. And here what happened is suddenly very unusual happened, because we were one of the first to hear it, being almost at the end. We heard a tremendous noise emanating from the back, and shortly thereafter we see huge tanks with a white star painted in front of the tank. Of course, the first thing we thought, the Russians are coming from the back. But as they were getting closer to us, we see suddenly a very curious phenomenon. We were walking, we were on a highway. On one side of the highway was a field, and on the other side was a forest. And we suddenly see the SS people, the German guard, running towards the forest, and the tanks are opening a machine gun, shooting in the forest after the SS men. And as they are coming closer, some people are sticking out, their heads are sticking out from the tanks, and they are waving us to us, "Go on the other side, go to the fields." Here we see the no more Germans, tanks coming, we start running to the fields, and they're shooting on the forest. And then the hatches open in every tank, and they started, we see here, packages are being thrown from the tanks to us on the field. And then shortly thereafter, we have learned these are not the Russians, but these are the American troops. And they ascended, and they were throwing to us food, canned ration, candies, biscuits, everything what they had in the tank, they would throw to us. So, in a way, this is how I was liberated on a highway going from Flossenbürg to Dachau. And the satirical part of it is that I had some friends that were in front of this convoy, and I later on found out the commandant of this convoy did not know what's going on in the back, because we still had maybe 5,000-6,000 people or so. Takes a lot of room, and it was a curve, so the guy in the front didn't know what's in the back, except that he had seen shooting, which he thought most probably it's the German guard shooting, and suddenly people are running out. And he, the commandant of the camp, started yelling, "Who gives orders here, I or somebody else?" And he, 2 minutes later, he was the one running to the forest.
Do you know how many people started with you from Flossenbürg?
To the best of my knowledge, there was about 14 to 16,000 people, and I think we were left maybe around 5. Again, this is just the estimates, because I didn't know.
So you were liberated in April of 1945?
Was liberated, yes, at the end of April of 45.
By the American Army?
By the Third Army, Patton's Third Army.
And you were in Bavaria?
And that was in Bavaria, yeah.
What did you do then?
We just found a little village where we were liberated. We went to the little village, and we went to a peasant, to a home of a peasant, and we lived there. He was happy that we didn't kill him, that we didn't do anything. He was happy to have us there. He gave us we took all the food, everything. And I think for the next few weeks, all we did is we ate, we slept, and that's it. It is remarkable that a number of our friends that also hid themselves as Jews did the same thing. So that within the next few days, we found out in the village about a dozen of our friends that were on the same transport that we did, that were liberated. They also did the same thing. So we...
Who were you living with? Your brother and anyone else?
In this particular peasant, just my brother and myself. And then the other friends went to another home of a peasant, and they stayed there. And it was a funny experience to find suddenly some other people that we were in the camp living in the same little village, and taking the food and eating day and night. And then we organized ourselves into a band. And we would go to other villages or whatever it is, and we would just take all the food we could find and bring it in so that we had for ourselves. It was also remarkable that after we came, I would say, to ourselves, that we were able to think and walk and do things, we of course took some clothes from all of them, and then we did something which I think young people, foolish people, can do it. There were around 4-6 of us that were in our age young. The rest of them were much older. And we found an old machine gun. We took the machine gun on the tree. We climbed on the tree with the machine gun. One of us stood high up on the tree with the machine gun, which was just the front part, what do you call it, of the machine gun. And we, the rest of us, would stay on the highway, and we would stop the convoys of Germans. What do I mean by conversion? Germans, as the American army was approaching and the Russian were approaching, the Germans, 50, 100 of them, were running away or going somewhere else. Many of them were really soldiers. Many of them were SS people. And here you have a bunch of 5, 6 young guys with one broken machine gun, stopping the whole convoy of people, 50, 60, 100 of them, and we were looking for SS people. And the way we were looking for the SS people, the easiest way, the real SS people, they had under the arm the signs SS. So we would tell them to stand up with their hands up, and we were looking for the SS people. And after a week or so, I mean, we could kill them, but somehow it was not in our blood to go ahead. And I have seen, look who is talking about sheep. Here you have the super race. 6 young boys stopping 50, 100 of them. The super race. We made them sit like this. And then the American convoys, the MPs, got to know us, and they would come every day and they would say, you have somebody for us. We would take the assessment and give it to them, to the American army, to the MPs. So this is our liberation.
Do you know the name of the town?
Yeah, the name of the town is Stamstraat. So we were in this little town, I don't know how long, for quite a while. And then we went to a bigger camp, the bigger town, also not very big, but a much bigger camp, town by the name of Kam. This town was not too far from Regensburg, but it was still a small city. I and my brother, we did not want to go to any DP camps. At that point, they had a lot of DP camps and so on. We did not want to go to any DP camps.
Why not?
Because we had enough camps. We decided no more camps for us. We were in the camps. We went together in these camps. We did not want to have any camps. I did not feel that after what we went through these camps, why should I go to the camp? No reason if I can live in freedom and so on. What we did do is, after we came to ourselves and we moved to Kam, some of our friends were musicians. And so that my brother, myself, and 2 other young boys, at this time we were young men, we organized a band from the people that were musicians. We organized a band, we called it the Happy Boys. And we organized a band, and they used to play for them to American soldiers and so on. And in this way, we got everything what we wanted. We had food, cigarettes, and we had the car. So that this was our life, really, just after the war in Germany.
Did you have any idea what you wanted to do in the long term?
Oh, in the first few months, nobody from us, at least, entertained any thoughts as to short terms or long terms. We lived really fairly from day to day, trying to do the best we can and to have everything what we want, to have food, to have clothes, to have cigarettes. And But we did know that this life, we did not want to stay there. We did not want to stay in Germany. This we knew. So, but that was really, at that point, a secondary thought. The first thought was something else. Our first thought at this time, once we came to ourselves, was to see if we can find members of our family and our friends. This was our primary thought. And this being the case, we started to search for our family.
We're going to pause now and change the tape. This is tape number 6 of the interview with Roman Kent, April 29th, 1996. So, when you came to come, you decided to try to find what had happened to your family members.
Yes, that is correct. And the question is, how do you find your family members just after the war? It is chaos. There's no line of communication. There's no telephones to speak of. There is no communities. There is no registrations. All the Jews that live basically in Poland are all dispersed, God knows only where. So that the only way that we thought how we can find something about our family is to simply go from place to place where you had larger Jewish population assembled in one place, whether that would be in the cities, whether that would be in the displaced person camps, and simply ask questions. We found out that many of these communities were in the same position that we were, many of the people. They were looking for each other. Therefore, in many of the places, they used to make a list of people that lived there. In some other places, you just had to ask and have you pat luck. And so we really traveled all over the Germany. When I say we traveled, it was my brother, myself, and two of our friends that were liberated at the same time. We traveled as the four of us, and we asked for the question, did you meet my sister, my mother, my friend? And one day, when we were in Bergen-Belsen, which was then in the so-called British territory, and this also the question of the American territory, the British territory, the French territory, also did not add to the ease of finding people, because each one has his own rules and regulation, each one has military police and so on. But one day when we were when we arrived to Bergen-Belsen, we met a girl, young lady, whom we knew from before the war, and she was a friend of our sister, the oldest sister, Dasha. So, of course, the normal question, did you meet my sisters? And she told us, yes, I did. They were in Bergen-Belsen, but they left a few days ago because one of your sister is very sick, and the Swedish government took or is taking few thousand sick people to Sweden, and they're sending them to sanatoriums to see if they can do something to improve their health. And because this one sister was sick, the other sister went with her, since they didn't, since the Swedish government did not want to separate them. And we were told that they went to Bremerhaven, to Lübeck, which was not far from there, and they are supposed to go the next day or day after to Sweden. Now, having heard that, that of course gave us some extra wings, and we went to the British military police to ask them for a special permit to travel that night to go to Lübeck. I cannot forget the British captain who was in charge of this so-called permits or whatever it is, a heavyset guy sitting behind the desk, and he, after listening to us what we want to do, his only answer is, look, late is too late, you cannot travel at night, you have to wait till tomorrow. Of course, we were not too happy with the reply, and we told him in no uncertain terms, whether you want to or not, whether you give us the permit or not, we are going to go to Lübeck at night, and we are going to find our sister. He got angry, put you to jail, and I said, it's okay, we went through it, we're going to go to them. And of course we did go to Lübeck, which never was too easy, because you didn't have a regular means of transportation. You had to hitchhike, you had to go by trains, you had to hold yourself there without any permission. It was not easy, but we did go there. And we went there to the sending off place, which was like a partial type of a hospital, and we found our sisters. It was something very unusual and touchy to see my older sister laying in bed, just skin and bones and just her eyes. And when she have seen us, it was like you could look in her eyes and see, it's a miracle. It's a miracle. Here we are after what they went through, and suddenly she found us. It was an unbelievable sight to see her this way. And we discussed the matter with the doctors there, and we were told that, look, I understand you want to be together, but there is really not too much you can do for her in Germany. She is so sick that we don't have, there's no treatments in Germany, and even if she will go to Sweden, we don't know what can be done for her, because she's simply too far gone. So having heard this, we really had no choice but to let them go to Sweden. And this is where we found each other for a few hours, really, and then we separated again. They went to Sweden. And unfortunately, the doctors were right. My older sister, Dasha, died in Sweden a few months later. And yet, although she died in Sweden officially, it is not that she died in Sweden. It is, she died in the Holocaust. It is the German people that killed her, although she died a few months later.
What happened to your mother?
We found out from early from the other sister, the younger sister, because Dasha was unable to talk. But we found out from Renya that our mother became sick a couple of times in the camp, and they were able to keep her. But once she got quite sick, and they took her to the hospital. And a few days later, they took all the people from the hospital and they sent them out. And that's the last that she heard from my mother. So that, like, they were just killed. That's what they did to all the people from the hospital. So afterwards, my other sister stayed in Sweden. We were at that point still in Germany. But after we came to the United States, which was in 1946, we were trying to see if we can send her an affidavit to bring her here. But it was not so easy for us because we didn't have anybody here, so that we could not send her ourselves the affidavit. We had to get it through somebody, which took time. And in the meantime, she stayed there and she got married, so she already remained in Sweden.
What time in 1946 did you come to the United States?
I came in June 1946. As a matter of fact, I came on the second boat that came from Germany to the United States. And I came under the auspices of the United States government. At that time, the United States government took, I believe, several thousand orphans and gave them a blanket affidavit. So that's the way we came here. And they were both Jews and Gentiles. And first we came to New York. And in New York they separated the different religious, boys and girls, depending on their religious denomination. And they sent them out to the Catholics, to under Catholics auspices, the Jews under the Jewish auspices, and so on. So, since we did not have anybody, so my brother and myself were sent to Atlanta, Georgia.
Where did you live?
We lived. We lived with a Jewish family that, as I said, the U.S. government sent the dispersed the people to different cities and gave the jurisdiction to different organizations, so that our organization in Atlanta was, I believe, Hebrew Orphans Home, and they placed us with a family. It was a Jewish family that lived in Atlanta.
What was the name of the family? Do you remember?
Yes, I remember, but although I'm trying to forget it. But we did not have a very pleasant experience with this family, unfortunately. It was a family which was very well off, and they took us there to their home, but they really did not understand, or maybe they did not want to understand the the problems with the survivors. And they did not understand that when they take us to their home, and when we are going, and that when we go to school, we need to have a breakfast, we need to have lunch. We have no money to buy breakfast, we have no money to buy lunch. And since we did not get this there, because maybe they took it as natural that we can buy and do whatever we want, we would go to school with no breakfast and no lunch. So that I know after a few months we wanted to go back to Europe. We say, if this is America and I've got to start here, where do I need it? So in a way the office was very angry. And at that point, of course, they couldn't believe us. How can it be possible, such a fine family? See, one has nothing to do with the other. And they said, no, no, we don't want you to go, and we find you another family. And they did find us another family. The person that took us, she was a widow. She was not well off. But she had a good heart, and that's what we needed most. So that when my brother and myself, when we went to school, we had breakfast, we had lunch, and we remained in contact with her till she passed away. My children were in contact with her till she passed away. And in a way, they called her her grandma, because we didn't have any grandma.
And you went to school?
Yes, we went to school in Atlanta, Georgia. Actually, what happened, we went to for a year to high school. And then we went to the university. So we went to Emory University in Atlanta. And my brother continued the studies, and he went later to medical school, and later on he went to a neurosurgical school, and he became a neurosurgeon. And I went to business. The unfortunate thing is that after all the schooling which my brother went through to be a neurosurgeon, he died at a very young age. So that's a great tragedy for his family, for his wife, for his two children. And also for me, because he was not just a brother, he was in a way a part of me. We went through the war together, and I know when I found out that he has cancer, I know I didn't want to accept it, and I told him, remember, right now, it's 20 years ago. We went through the war, we didn't have any chance, and yet we made it. You just can't believe it. And he told me, yes, Roman, we didn't have much of a chance, but somehow we had a little chance. What I have right now, I have no chance. I want, I don't want. The clock is ticking. I've got 2 years maximum. Doesn't matter what I want. That is what I have. And he was right. He was in 2 years. He almost to the day. That's when we lost him. So it is a great loss, not only for our families but also for the mankind, because he was an extremely brilliant neurosurgeon. So that's a big loss.
When were you married?
About 37 years ago.
What's your wife's name?
Hannah. Her maiden name was Starkman. By coincidence, she also came to the United States under the same children's quota, and she came on the first boat, so she's the Mayflower girl. But I came on the second boat.
How did you meet?
We met in New York when my brother, at that time he was married and he was taking internship in Kings County Hospital. So we lived together because I moved from Atlanta to New York and he came to New York to be together. His wife also was a friend of my present wife. They came together on the first boat and they had a reunion. So that my wife came to New York for the reunion, and since I lived together with my brother, we met, and this is how it started.
And you've had children?
Yes, we have two children, a girl and a boy, and in a way, I would say that if you were to ask me, what are my accomplishments, I would say that maybe the most important accomplishment is that we have two children which I consider a really good human beings. And that means a lot.
What are their names?
Susan and Jeffrey.
And you have grandchildren?
Yes, we have a couple of them. Our daughter is married and she's got two children, two girls, by the name of Dara and Erin. And as I'm talking to you, she's expecting another one, maybe in September.
If I can back up just a little bit, when did you change your name?
That goes many, many years ago. And we changed the name in Atlanta, Georgia. And as a matter of fact, my records in Emory University, I still under the old name, Kniker, K-N-I-K-E-R. But what was happening there at that particular for the Southerner, this was an extremely difficult name to pronounce, Kniker. And how do you spell it and how you pronounce it? And therefore, we decided that somehow for simplicity, both my brother and myself, we changed the name, which is easy. It was no problem how to pronounce it.
How did you decide upon the name that you chose?
I imagine if I were to look at it, for no reason, you know, somebody asked, how come Exxon became Exxon? They took, I believe, computer, and they found out the name Exxon, a crazy name like this. We didn't have any computers. We just, like anything, like many things in life, it just happened. No rhyme, no reason.
Could you tell me a little bit about the volunteer work that you've done?
You know, it's a difficult question because I don't like to talk so much about what I do, because I do this I feel that I should do without advertising what and how. As you have seen, I went through ghetto, Auschwitz, other things. And in a way, considered everything else after the war. I came here with nothing and went to school, went to university, went to business. And some people may say, you accomplished a lot. That may be so. But therefore I feel that after what I went through, I should give back something to the society that I received. And therefore I feel that it is important for us to, what I have installed in my children, I hope, not to be a bystander. I think the atrocities which happened because of what I call the world stood by and did nothing. But the world is a big world. The world consists of individuals. And therefore, it is important that individuals do things, that individuals be involved and get involved. So in a way, this is the reason why I have decided to do something to give to others that maybe are less fortunate. So yes, I am involved in various projects. I am involved in the projects of keeping the memory of the Holocaust alive, so that maybe the new generation can learn something from it, so that it will not be repeated again. Yes, I am involved in helping the righteous Gentiles, the few individuals that saved the Jewish life during the war, because I think they are the perfect example that even among the most horrible circumstances, the people that are moral and ethical, they can do something. Yes, there were very few righteous Gentiles, but therefore they are so important, because their example shows us what can be done if people care. And particularly in Poland, to help a Jew meant that if the Gentiles are caught, they lose their life, their family lose their life. So what I want to bring up, that even in the midst of the atrocities, there is some goodness. And it is always easier to teach the new generation if you show them not only the evil, but if you show them you have the right to be good, you should be good. So that the memory and the acts of the righteous Gentile serve a dual purpose of teaching what happened, but also of teaching of what can be done if people care. And today, so many of the righteous Gentiles are old and they are sick. So, yes, I am working to help them out. And we have right now maybe 1,200 the righteous Gentiles that we are helping them financially. people that are in need.
I'm going to pause and change the tape.
Yeah.
This is tape number 7 of the interview with Roman Kent, April 29th, 1996.
In addition, just as important, if not more so, as the righteous Gentile, is a question also of the Holocaust survivors. Yes, I am quite involved in the retaining the memory of the Holocaust, but I am also very much involved in the helping the needy survivors. It is not a well-known fact that there are thousands of survivors today that are alive, but that they are in a poor physical condition. They are in a poor mental condition. They have no family. They have no friends. And in many instances, one of the spouses is dead, and when the other person is by himself or herself, they are in a very bad shape. It's somehow, many people think that the Germans pay reparation to the Holocaust survivors, and they do pay to some, but there are thousands, tens of thousands survivors that are in a condition, as I described before, that need desperately help. Both they need a monetary help as well as a mental and medical help. So that I am very much lately involved in negotiating with the German government to make sure that the people that did not receive any compensation, and all of them are entitled as far as I am concerned, except for the laws with the German past, which does not give them the money, that this should be reversed, and that the people could at least live the last years of their lives in some kind of dignity. As I mentioned also about memory, yes, it is important that our lives and the lives of our families that perish will not be in vain. So to this aim, I am involved with the preserving the memory of the Holocaust, and I am very active in the American Gathering of Jewish Holocaust Survivors. I have also been involved in conjunction with the Holocaust and what happened with the Soviet jewelry, because I felt that the problem with the world was that they stood by and did nothing. And therefore, we that survived had a moral obligation to raise the voices and try to free the Jews in Russia to live in dignity. And I am happy that this time the American Jews, by and large, did not do what they did during the last war, with the perfect, the infamous example is the St. Louis boat, to send it back with the Jews to Germany for their dead, but that they did raise their voice and were very instrumental in freeing tens of hundreds of thousands of Russian Jews. Also like to be active in any kind of equality, and therefore I am quite involved with the Anti-Defamation League which tries to have law and justice for everyone. I was very much involved in recognizing the Danish people as an example that they stood by Jews, and it was my privilege to give the Danish people what we call the shofar of freedom in recognition for their acts during the Holocaust.
Well, I want to thank you very much for speaking with us this morning, or this afternoon, rather. Before we stop and look at some of the pictures that you have, is there anything else that you'd like to add? Any final thing that you'd like to say?
Well, I don't know if you want, you have in front of you some of the books which was made from the meeting of survivors in 1983, which was maybe the largest, the first in the United States, large scale public expose on the life of the survivors in the United States. I was privileged to take the integral part in preparing this event, where we had 20,000 people, 20,000 survivors gathered in Washington for 3 days. And we had all dignitaries, starting from the president down, participating in our meetings. As a matter of fact, even a newspaper like the Washington Post recognized the not only the importance but the dignified way the three-day meeting was conducted, that they have made, 80-page booklet just dedicated to the gathering of Jewish Holocaust survivors. And the usual part about this book was that there was not even one line of advertising. And for newspaper to make an 80-page book without any advertising, it's the first time in the history. 2 years later, we made a very important meeting in Washington also, where we celebrated. That's the city of the brotherly love, and we celebrated there also, which was also attended by 12,000 survivors, and I was also very instrumental in putting it together.
So I guess if there's nothing else that you'd like to say, we'll take a look at some of the pictures that you have now.
Yes, to say that could be volumes to be said, but I think we have enough for today.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. This is the only picture which I have of my family from before the war. And starting from right to left, it's my father, my brother, Leon, who died about 20 years ago, who was with me in the war all the time. It's my sister, Dasha, the oldest sister, who perished just after the war because of malnutrition. Then is my sister, Renya, who lives in Sweden and in Israel. Next to her is myself, and then is my mother. This is a picture which we have received from our superintendent of the factory, who had it in his possession, and he gave it to us. This is a picture, the only picture which I have from the ghetto, and this picture was published by a friend of mine who wrote a diary in the ghetto, who was my classmate, and who also perished during the war. Out of all these friends of mine that we went together to school, only two are alive together today. One On the right side is Marian Turski, who is alive, and the other person on the left side is Nonek Fluk. It is very unusual that even though we did not see each other for 20, 25 years, all our families are extremely close today. So it is a pleasure to know that at least two of my friends and their families and my family are very close. This is also a picture, one of a kind, which was taken not long after the war in Stam Street. And as you look at the picture, you will see a person on the right side, which is me, Roman Kent. And the unusual part thing about the picture is that this is the suit which I had, my last suit in Flossenbürg. And if you look closely at it, you will see on my chest there is this is actually a number, my number in the camp, and on the coat there should be two letters, one K and the other one L, which stood for concentration camp Lager. So that's a very unique picture that I have. Really, it is from the camp which was shut after the war. This is also one of the very few pictures which I have, which was taken after the war, a few months after the war. And this is taken in the city of Cham. And on the right side is my brother Leon, at that time it was Knicker. And on the left side it's myself, Roman Knicker. This is also a picture taken in Cham a few months after the war. And I, Roman Kent, am on the right side of the picture. And the rest of the boys, I call them boys, they were grown-up men, were part of the orchestra under the name of the Happy Boys. And they were happy after the war. This is also an unusual picture which depicts some of my friend and myself and my brother on our way to the United States. In other words, we were sent by the train to Bremerhaven under the auspices of UNRWA, and from there we were sent on a boat to the United States. This is a picture taken also in 1946, in June 1946, and it depicts the gangplank, although we don't see the boat, which took us to the United States. And the trains in the back are depicting trains that were bringing survivors to this boat. This is somehow a very unusual picture, which I would call maybe the road to freedom. This is taken on the boat in 1946 when we are on the way to coming to the United States. This was really a transport boat, marine perch. And you see my brother Leon and myself sticking the head through the round windows. This is me, Roman Kent, shortly after arriving to the United States. So it's taken sometimes July, August 1946. I was young at that time. This is my brother, Leon Kent, whom I missed every day. This must be a picture taken sometimes in 46, 47 in the United States. And I just think about him all the time. I wish he were with us. This picture brings a lot of memories, some the horrible ones and some good ones. This is a picture taken during my filming of the documentary Children of the Holocaust, which was dedicated to the annihilation of 1.5 million children. This picture depicts my wife Hannah Kent and myself Roman in front of the Auschwitz, and at the same time the filming crew is working on this film. This was done in 1979-80. My son was so taken by the picture shown previously of my wife and myself in front of the wire in Auschwitz that he made this collage, and which depicts my wife and myself, the silhouettes of both of us. And then he wrote a little poem, which I would say, which reads as follows: "Let the bloodshed be the conscience that, like the ocean, swallows those who seek to master it. But let this flood leave a stain that cannot be engulfed without a trace." I wish to thank Jeffrey Kent for doing this beautiful collage. This is the third picture in the series dedicated to the filming of the Children of the Holocaust, which was an important part in my life since it was dedicated to 1.5 million children. This is the end of the shooting, and as you see, myself and Liv Ullmann embracing each other at the accomplishment of this film. This picture depicts my wife Hannah, my son Jeffrey, and myself Roman Kent signing the scroll of remembrance, which took place during our gathering in Washington in April 1983. This was indeed a most memorable event that is remembered by anyone who participated, and even the ones that did not participate. This picture is taken in 1985, and it's taken during our meeting in Philadelphia, and it depicts the Danish ambassador and myself, where I am presenting him with the scroll of remembrance, the shofar of remembrance, for the role of the Danish people that and the parts he played during the Holocaust and saving the Jews during that time. This represents a pamphlet pertaining to a conference, the first international conference which we held in Warsaw, Poland, pertaining to the righteous Gentiles, which was entitled also "Can Indifference Kill?" I was very proud to make and to chair this conference, because it showed not only the evil, but the goodness that can exist. This conference was attended by the leading scholars politicians and clergymen from various countries, from the United States, from Poland, from Sweden, from Israel. This is a picture which was taken recently in 94, which depicts Hillary Clinton and myself at the White House.
What was the occasion that you were at the White House?
The occasion at this, I really don't remember what was the exact occasion. This is a picture of Yitzhak Rabin and myself, Ramon Kent, which was taken about 2 years ago. And one of the reasons of this picture is that I was very much involved in helping the Israeli soldiers, particularly in helping them to get some social amenities, etc. This picture really represented evidence, the evidence that are left after the war and that will continue, I hope, the work which we started. This is my daughter, Susan, and her two children. The one hanging upstairs is Dara, and the little one below, Aaron. This is a very memorable picture because it represents a group of my friends and my family that came into the Polish consulate when I was awarded a special medal from the Polish government. As you see me in the middle of the upper picture with the kind of a blue and gold medal on my lapel, and next to me on the left is my son, Jeffrey. On the right side next to me is my son-in-law, Bob. And if we will go to the lower row, below, right below me is my daughter, Susan. And next to her on the left is my wife, Hannah. This is a picture depicting my son Jeffrey and myself on the occasion of receiving an award for the help and work I did to get the Soviet Jews out of Russia. It was indeed a very proud moment for me and also for Jeffrey, since, like he said in his remark, it was really his night to present me with the award.
Could you please introduce your family?
Yes, this is my wife Hannah, and next to her is our dividend Jeffrey.
Were you aware when you were younger of your parents' experiences?
I can't remember a time when I wasn't. I used to know other people who were children of survivors who were not as informed. Mine, it was part of our life. I remember, even at a very, very young age, even being upset when I would be at other people's homes, whether they were Holocaust survivors or just Jewish families, where I'd hear racist remarks or other kind of comments that bothered me, and I would come home crying and expecting that everyone who went through the Holocaust or was aware of it would then know that prejudice was not good. And that's when I remember always being told by my mother that the war didn't make good or bad people, it probably made you more of what you were already. And I learned that lesson at a very young age. And that's probably would mark my whole childhood, and my family always teaching me that just the love between a mother and a child is the same no matter what race or religion or anything else. And I used to, as a very young child, think that came from their war experiences, but it came probably from a combination of who they were before the war, the kind of people they were, amplified by what they went through.
Is there anything else that any of you would like to add or say before we say goodbye?
I think it up to all those hours. We don't have anything very much to add, unless my husband has. I know we are a very happy, normal family with lovely children. And we hope there will be peace in the world. And nobody has to go through what we have gone through.
And I think maybe I should leave the last word to our son, because he is the future of the mankind, not we, so.
Well, I hope it's not resting on my shoulders, I'm glad that this is kind of thing, project is being done. I think there can never be enough material. Everything, every story needs to be told. And there's no one ultimate story. Everything that happened, and each piece just helps you learn from it, hopefully. And most importantly is just everyone not to be infected by that which you fight against. Many people who, let's say, I remember very often, because of what my parents went through, people would expect me to, let's say, marry quote-unquote Jewish or whatever that means, and I wouldn't even understand what that word means. It would be like, as if Hitler won, that if you're Jewish, you were born differently. The fact is, we are all the same. The Jewish culture has some very good things about it, and one should learn from it. And most importantly, was I think in Pirkei Avot, there's, I think it's book 5, chapter 20, verse 22, that says, he who has a generous eye, a humble spirit, and a gentle, a kind soul, is a disciple of Abraham. That basically the Jewish religion is not divided such as the Catholic religion. The dogma is more, if you're a good person, you're a good Jew, or considered to be a good Jew. I think that's how I was raised, and that's how I view it. And hope all this documenting the various stories help.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope you can have a good night to rest after all the day.